Hello, my name is Duncan Urquhart, and welcome to Delving the Dungeon, a critical examination of Dungeons & Dragons in the modern context. Dungeons & Dragons, or D&D, is one of the first tabletop role-playing games, or TTRPGs. It was substantially popular when it first came out in 1974. Lately, however, it has been seen more, it has seen more of a revival through pop culture, live streaming, and podcasts. The representation in modern media that it has gotten has had people interested in it, and primarily as a hobby to enjoy with friends. D&D requires a high amount of creativity, and coming up with stories from the tools that the game provides. And creating creative work breeds more creative work. So firstly, we'll look into Chris Lawson, who is a Peterborough local who has a podcast called Monster Manual Mash, where he and a friend examine the lore and stories behind each of the monsters in the D&D Monster Manual. He and I had a conversation about his journey with the game.
I started playing because my older brother had piles of books, piles of like garage sale role-playing game books from the 80s, because he was like 8 years older than me. So he had a ton of stuff laying around, and I got into it, and I was like the little whiny kid that wanted to play with him and his friends. So he would let me play, but he did this weird power move where he would tell me that I was a character, and then he would like just play it as an NPC. He'd be like, I was the unicorn, and I got to be the unicorn. And then when the unicorn was there, my brother just like did whatever. But he just told me that I was that thing to like appease me and leave him alone. So that was kind of my first experience. And then I would take the books and try to run them for my own friends, but they were way too advanced for me. So I wasn't actually playing the games. I was just kind of like my best approximation of what I thought a role-playing game was, I would run for my friends. After that, I didn't play role-playing games for a long time. I didn't play at all in high school. I laughed when my friend suggested we should play, because I thought I got so out of touch with it that I thought it was like, in the words of Ice-T, some deep, deep nerd shit. And then we tried it, and like, I've never looked back. It's like one of the most major hobbies and interests of my life. So, but I didn't really truly start playing it until like the year after I graduated high school.
That's actually a very similar situation to myself. My father introduced it to me and a couple of friends back when I was 10 years old, and it was a bit of a mess because we were all just like, oh, this is interesting. We can all be barbarian murder hobos. And then I didn't play it or touch it until my first year of university, when a friend just made a cold call being like, hey, I play D&D. Do you want to play?
So for D&D in particular, what I do is a podcast. I do a show called Monster Manual Mash with my good friend, Wes Grist. He does a lot of the technical stuff and the music, and he and I will talk about, we do a show where we open the Monster Manual book, 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons, and we go through each entry, and we take each individual monster and we talk about it for like an hour and a half. And we get into, like, what interests me about these things is that they are universal and they keep coming up. So like every edition of Dungeons and Dragons has certain monsters, and these monsters are often plucked from folklore and mythology, but also a bunch of them are just from the imaginations of the people that made it. And those monsters are just as iconic and recognizable and beloved as the ones that come from like European folklore and abroad. And I find it really interesting the way monsters kind of get their hooks in us psychologically. Like, what about a goblin? What about it makes us as human beings keep imagining them and want to like deal with them and put them in our like our imagination games? So what I try to do is I look at the history, and we look at like what you're supposed to be feeling when you are encountering a goblin, because fantasy deals in like archetypes and kind of primal emotions. So what are we dealing with in the human mind when we are talking about goblins? And hopefully it's more entertaining than it sounds, but that's kind of the gist of the of my you called it my creative work, which is high praise, than just kind of loftier than I imagine what I'm doing, but that's what I do.
Do you think that your podcast would work as a radio show, let's say in the early 90s?
No. No. And this is the thing that's happening with all kind of audio media right now. It's niche, it's specialty. This could not exist on any other medium other than the internet because the audience would not find it. There's no space for it on mainstream radio. So not a chance.
And do you think that part of your success is or could be accredited to the fact that there are actual play podcasts around in the current podcast climate?
I think everything that deepens the pool of media around the topic helps. Well, there's a better phrase for what I'm trying to say. The rising tide lifts all ships, something like that. Like the success of something like an actual play podcast just increases interest in the broader hobby and industry. So I would say, yes, actual play podcasts, Critical Role, stuff like that. The reason anyone at all would listen to my podcast is because they're already engaged and interested and hungry for more content. So having, like, it's a tabletop role-playing games are a niche. And then within that niche, there's Dungeons and Dragons, which is probably like the biggest player, but it's still not the whole thing. And then like podcasts concerning Dungeons and Dragons is even more niche. And then there are even more subtypes of that. There's like the actual play, and then there's more kind of like analytical stuff like mine, which is like, it's funny because I do not like actual play podcasts. I have tried. I've tried really hard because I see everyone else having so much fun with it and getting into Critical Role, and I love voice acting, but I just can't do it. I don't know why. It throws me off.
For context, Critical Role is a popular live stream done Thursday night every week. It is done by Matthew Mercer as well as many other voice actors. It has become quite popular and is a very large introduction to many people around the age of, let's say, 13 to 25. To get into Dungeons & Dragons, it shows that they can have fun but also create a story together. Looking to a younger crowd than Chris Lawson, I interviewed my own friend and Dungeon Master, Gabe Gelgor, a student at UOIT. He is the one who properly introduced me to the game, and he views D&D as a way to explore new ideas, new perspectives, and as a way to grow as a person. Let's listen. When did you start playing Dungeons & Dragons?
So that would have been sometime late middle school. Basically, I went to a summer, not even a summer camp. I think this was just a weekend programming school. This is when I originally first started learning how to program. And it was near the end of the semester for this weekend programming school. And the teacher, just one day we showed up and he had on the board, it was like a whiteboard, just a grid drawn out, and he's like, "Yo, you guys want to play some Dungeons and Dragons?" And I'm like, "What is this magical thing? It sounds fantastic." So that was my very first exposure to it. And from there, I kind of just grew into more of a fascination.
So I guess we'll talk about you as a DM, because I think that you very much enjoy this role.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I guess as a DM, who is your biggest inspiration?
A lot of what I utilize inspiration-wise comes mostly out of music, like listening to music and kind of creating these scenes in my head. So the occasional poem, but very substantially is my daydreams. I was a very heavy daydreamer growing up, especially throughout like elementary school, middle school, parts of high school. I'm sure you personally could, looking back, could probably pinpoint moments in time where I was daydreaming rather than paying attention to the world around me. And all the time that I was daydreaming actually kind of was me, for lack of a better word, world building of my setting. The setting that you guys are actually playing in and the campaign that I'm currently running for you has been something that has been mostly inspired by these kind of like midday fantasies that I've been having since like as long as I can really remember. If we're talking more so about style, obviously like people like Matthew Cavill, then there's also Matthew Mercer and a bunch of other really cool online DMs that I've seen, but I don't particularly remember their names. It's definitely DMing or game mastering, GMing, I should say, is definitely somewhat of an interesting hybrid of storyteller and actor. And as such, you can pick up on like a variety of different styles. So I think kind of getting back to the original point, my biggest inspiration, I don't know if I have one, it's more of a like conglomeration of just kind of all of these disparate things kind of forming into my own style of storytelling. I hope that answers your question. What I find the progression of, especially the progression of being a better DM for me, has been a lot of the time running these storytelling sessions with players and then kind of walking away being like, okay, Gabe, what worked in this session? What worked in another session? And how do you try and fix those minor details that you've noticed kind of you aren't so happy with? And that's kind of been what, for the specific act of game mastering, that is my particular way of getting better and like measuring progress.
You talk about this narrative process and this creative process that you have in this way of storytelling, but D&D is called a role-playing game. Do you think that this is an accurate word, the use of game, for the way that you use D&D?
That's an interesting question, in the sense that when you're saying like role-playing game, yeah, I mean, overall, it's very much, you literally are stepping into the role of another person in these games. And a lot of the times, I mean, originally, when you first start playing as a player, when you're creating characters, you start off by kind of experimenting with aspects of your personality that maybe you haven't gotten to explore before, and you create these characters, and through playing the game, you kind of get to explore those aspects that maybe you aren't so comfortable exploring. Otherwise, I know many a person that's a manly man, I guess, so to say, that would have had a very, almost like a suppressed effeminate side, not so much suppressed, but maybe a better word for it is subdued. And the characters that they were playing were always like these dainty, they were like a muscly person. And then they were always playing like this dainty, like elven sorcerer type thing. So kind of like exploring those aspects of your personality that maybe you don't get the chance to normally. And then the most interesting thing to me is that as soon as you get past that, because eventually you kind of lose interest in creating these reflections of yourself, and you start doing something completely different. And that's awesome, because now you're not just exploring yourself, but you are exploring the experiences of a totally different person, maybe like a person of a different gender, of a different racial background. And that is the basis of empathy, right?
And that is the basis of empathy. Moving on, Jason is a fellow English major here at Trent University and was a big theater kid in high school. We quickly became friends over our shared hobby. However, the best part of playing D&D together is that we, as two creative writers, are able to work together to create a story both like and unlike the ones that we read and listen to. For Jason, D&D is a way to both write his story and to play a character.
I'm kind of like a Dungeons & Dragons baby on the grand scale. I got into it October or September, around that time of 2017. So it's been about a year and a half since I started like playing or running the game. Yeah.
And how did you get into that? Was it a friend? Was it someone older than you? Or was it something online?
So I went to Guelph a lot to visit a friend, and one of her friends who lived with her, one of her roommates, he approached me and was like, hey, I have been playing D&D for a long time, but I haven't run anything yet. Like, if I run something, are you interested in playing? And I said, absolutely. Like, I've seen it like on Stranger Things or whatever, but I had never really played it and I didn't really know what I was getting into. But he was like, I want to try it. And I was like, I'll just give it a shot for like, you know, I'll play for a couple hours and I'll see how I like it. And then it kind of just took off from there. Became kind of a hobby of mine.
I think you've mentioned before, just like when we've talked about earlier, that you are a fan of Critical Role and you're a fan of Matt Coville. So when exactly did that start?
The guy who was running my dungeon master, or was my dungeon master right at the beginning, he showed me Critical Role. He was like, hey, there's this show on Twitch every Thursday. You should go watch it because like they're professional voice actors and it's a really good time. And I was like, yeah, I'll give that a shot too. And then it ended up that like I started watching that every week. So it's another like 4 hours of D&D that I'm consuming every week. And then Matt Coville, I ran across him. I think I was just looking up resources online, and I ended up running across his Running the Game series, which is just, it's very, very good for like new and kind of like semi-experienced Dungeon Masters. Yeah, it's kind of like his audience for that. So it's more educational than Critical Role is.
Yeah, 100%. That's actually the resource that I found online when I started running my first games, which you were a part of. Most of your experience comes from being a player in D&D. You, in the past, have quite often used character voices, and you come up with very elaborate characters, and you and I have talked about how you have like 30 odd characters right now in the bank that you want to try out at some point or another. Could you walk us through that creative process and what inspires you for these characters and how you think of them?
Yeah, so like the biggest thing for D&D for me is it's a creative outlet, both for writing and for acting, which are two things that I don't get to do outside of a professional kind of environment all the time. I also haven't done acting since high school, if you don't count D&D. So it's a really good outlet for me. When it comes to like character creation, it's kind of a mix. Sometimes I just think of like an interesting kind of conceit for a character, like maybe just one or two personality traits, and I just build off of that. Or sometimes I'm just looking through the book and I'm like, hey, it'd be cool to play a divination wizard. I wonder how I can make that interesting and not fall into kind of the tropey aspects of like wizards or the tropey aspects of whatever race I want to play. So it's kind of a mixed bag between story and mechanics kind of driving whatever character I'm coming up with.
How do you feel about playing these characters in someone else's world? Because we talk about Dungeon Masters building worlds and creating this narrative, but you have a certain amount of agency as a player in that narrative. So how do you like to express that?
On the player side, it's just cool to like, because I really enjoy creative writing and I've kind of created my own world to run D&D in. But it's cool to see how people kind of take these elements and they kind of run with them. So for example, with you, like using the Norse pantheon in a lot of your games, that's like a really cool thing that you do that not a lot of other Dungeon Masters do. There's kind of like D&D gods, quote unquote, but you kind of take the Norse pantheon and you run with that, which is really cool. It's cool to see those different elements come together and like what people like ends up being in their game. So that's cool. As a player, it's cool to kind of have the ability to impact that world. Because as a Dungeon Master, you're writing, but you don't know what your players are going to do. You can't control that. So on the player side of it, it's just cool to kind of, a lot of the time, do something that your Dungeon Master doesn't expect and kind of see that look on their face where they're like, oh shit, I don't know what to do now. But it's cool to have that kind of impact. It definitely feels like you have an agency in a lot of these worlds, if the Dungeon Master's doing their job right, at the very least.
Recently, you've been more in the role of a Dungeon Master. And where have you been drawing your inspiration from that?
So a lot of my Dungeon Master inspiration comes from Matt Coville. The world that I've built is heavily based on his world. I've taken a lot of the elements from that. I've also kind of added some stuff that I enjoy, because his big philosophy is take the stuff you like and put it in your game, and I've taken that to heart. So when it comes to kind of the Dungeon Master side for me, that he's a huge inspiration. He's the main reason why I kind of feel like I can do what I'm doing when I'm a Dungeon Master.
Other than that, is there any sort of way that you draw inspiration? Like you're an English major. Mm-hmm. Do you find yourself thinking about narrative tropes from, you know, course readings or maybe things that you've read for pleasure and anything like that, even music?
Oh, definitely. For me, the stuff that I'm kind of exposed to in an academic setting definitely impacts me. Like I had just read Dracula for one of my classes, and all of a sudden I was thinking about vampire arcs, and that got me into werewolf arcs, and I kind of run with that. You mentioned music, I wanted to touch on that, because for me, music is, it's very much part of my D&D experience. I make character playlists, so songs that I feel either match the character in sound or in lyrics, just kind of the general mood. So that's like a huge part of it. And then obviously when I'm running the game or when I'm playing in a game, it's really, really cool to have the atmospheric music that kind of brings you into the setting. So I think music's actually a really big part of Dungeons & Dragons that kind of gets glossed over. It definitely takes a backseat for the most part, but it's a really important element for me.
Your characters, you talk about these personality traits that they have and breaking the mold of certain class stereotypes, you know, bard being a man whore, a wizard being a bookie nerd, and clerics being just the devout priest. Do you feel as though your characters, when in the world that your DM creates, do you feel as though you have agency as Jason, or your characters have agency in this world and they just play out the way that they would play out rather than you playing them?
I think obviously a lot of, or at least most of my characters, they have this element of, or at least a part of them is me. There's always, no matter how separate I am from the character personality, I feel like there's always an element of that character that I relate to. So it's very easy for me to kind of slip into that. And at least like, if I can exaggerate that in myself, I can kind of get in the headspace of the character that I'm building. But when it comes to the agency, comes to like who's kind of making the decisions, that's a really interesting question. I think it's impossible to not think about what you think would be fun as a player, but sometimes it doesn't align with what you think your character would do. So there's always that constant struggle. And I think I try to find a balance for it, but it's, you know, sometimes you give in to what Jason wants to do and not what your character wants to do.
So do you find that might influence how you play rather with people? Do you think that maybe part of those decisions that Jason makes rather than, say, Mako makes, your half-orc cleric, do you think that those decisions are driven by, you know, maybe wanting what's best for the group as, you know, people having fun? Or do you think it's something that you just think would save the story?
I think it depends on the character. Like for Mako, he is a lot about like personal strength and personal kind of overcoming obstacles. But in that way, he likes to kind of push his companions to do the same. So I think for the most part, all of my characters kind of like to work in like a group setting, which means that me as a player, I also enjoy working in that group setting. I kind of, you know, push my other players, especially if they're newer players, to kind of take more leadership roles. And I kind of, you know, take a step back sometimes and let them do their thing. Just kind of making my character fit that is something that I do a lot, that kind of decision making.
So you would never per se make a protagonist?
I think that that is an easy trap to fall into. And I try not to do it for sure. But it's easy to kind of make a character that you think is really interesting and that you think everyone else is going to find interesting. But at the end of the day, D&D is a collaborative experience. There shouldn't be just one main character. So that is a tough trap to not fall into, but it's really, really important, at least I think, not to kind of make a protagonist or a main character. Someone that fits into a group is important.
In your recent experience, you've gotten to play more characters and explore more of these personalities. Does one maybe come to mind when you say, like, something you've really enjoyed playing in the past little while? Is there one character that you may find favorable? I don't want to say your favorite, but one that you may find favorable right now?
I think you might know the answer to this question already, but I recently played a half-elven monk named Dex, who I thought was a blast to play. It wasn't something that I do very often. I kind of tend to stick to spellcasters. So playing a more martial class was a really cool experience for me. And it turns out monks can do a lot of really cool shit. So yeah, it was a really, really fun experience. And his personality, I think, was a little bit abrasive, but definitely interesting for me to kind of step into.
So could you give us a very quick rundown of who Dex was?
Sure. So Dex was a character I played in a one-shot that you ran with a lot of people who had never played D&D before. And Dex was a drunken master monk, which is a subclass that kind of, it emphasizes like swaying movements so that you don't get hit as often, or like being able to expose kind of weaker parts of the body so you can hit harder. Basically, if you can imagine like Jackie Chan in D&D, it's kind of that idea of like the silly martial arts character. But his kind of personality was, he was a monk that was also a charlatan. So he was trained up to a point and decided it wasn't for him. So he kind of ran away from his monastery, and then he made a living pretending that he could teach other people how to do martial arts, collecting on a down payment and then skipping town. So that was what he was doing up until the game started. So he wasn't exactly, he's definitely an example of a character that I didn't make in kind of an idea of a team player sense. He was more of a lone wolf, more of a independent guy, but he definitely, I think, supported the team that we were playing with. And I think he carried his weight for sure. I can say that much.
Yeah, he definitely carried his weight a whole lot more than maybe other characters who decided in the middle of combat that the best decision was to
jump off the side of the ship.
That's
the one I had in mind. Yeah.
So D&D is, yes, a fun hobby to play with your friends, but also a collaborative experience to create art. And that is what Jason and I find to be the most fun out of the game. For me, D&D is a method for friends to come together and create the stories that we want to see in the world. I love high fantasy, but I would also like to explore a narrative that actively included multiple people of color, and on that was more accepting of non-heterosexualities. Podcasts and live streams have become a way for people to share those stories. Podcasts like The Adventure Zone provide a way for heroes to fight against fascism, and for those medieval heroes to include a trans elf woman, a pansexual elf man, and for the series to happily end with a lesbian wedding. And to me, a young writer in 2019, that's much more inspiring than a lion who represents Jesus. I know that might be a bit of a hot take, but it's the one I'm going to end on. Thank you so much for joining me today in Delving the Dungeon. If you want to learn more about progressive RPGs and RPG storytelling, hit me up on Twitter or Instagram. I can be found at Dunksterable, that is DunCsterable, DunCsterable. Thank you very much, and until next time, I hope you don't jump off the side of a boat and get killed by a gelatinous cube.